Okay, so we'll be discussing two topics today. First is a feasibility study, and then we'll move to the behavioral model. So feasibility study, I have used the word like lot of times when we are going through the SDLC. So we'll learn what are the like what is a feasibility study, what do I mean by feasibility study, and what are the types of feasibility studies are there. Okay, people are joining. Okay, one more thing to announce. I think probably we'll have I think on Monday, I think next Monday, I'm not sure about the date exactly, but we'll be having this one quiz called Software Engineering via the Kraken platform. So everyone please prepare yourself. I'll let you know, like it will be MCQs only. On we know it's a quiz, right? So everyone please go through module 1 and module 2. Or only go through only module 1 actually, module 1, and then we'll have a quiz. Okay, then we'll be I think probably for half an hour, I think in Monday on Monday. So feasibility study, so basically what is feasibility study? So basically it's written here, right? For soft feasibility study in software engineering is a study to evaluate the feasibility of the proposed project or system. So you have to evaluate the system, whether you are like the system you are going to build, it's like appropriate to create it or not, whether we should go for the proposed project that is like whatever the recommendation is given by the client, should we like carry forward and move according to them or not. Okay, so basically it's the analysis or it's a measure of a software products in terms of how much beneficial that product development will be from the organization. So I once more, like again, I am repeating the things that the client, they are the layman. They don't have much of technical knowledge and everything, and whether it will be suiting our organization or not, whether it be practical or not. So in that case, we need to find out. We need to find whenever we find their requirements, then we go for the feasibility study. Why? Because that gives a brief idea whether how it will be benefit for the organization, whether we can develop the product or not. So this is what we go for the end. That is why it is known as a feasibility study. So feasibility study is carried out based on purposes to analyze whether software product will be right in terms of development, implantation, contribution of project to the organization, etc. So it totally depends upon the organization whether they should go for the particular proposed method, proposed project or not, based on their requirements. That is why like requirement analysis is done. So in the feasibility study part only we go for the software requirement specification, right? And the software requirement specification, we analyze whether that project will be developed or not, can be developed, we can take the risk and go for the project or no, whether it is not feasible. So what are the based on this is what is known as the feasibility study. Now we should know what are the types of feasibility study. It's not that by looking at the like requirement we say it like it's a whether it's feasible or not, yes or no, it's not. So we have to like look into these five kinds of feasibility study. So all of these criteria for feasibility study. The first is the technical feasibility, then we have operational feasibility, economical feasibility, legal feasibility, and schedule feasibility. So what is technical feasibility? So technical feasibility will basically analyze whether the hardware and software needed to develop the software project is are available or not, like whether they are working functionally properly or not. So see, if the hardware and requirement does not match to the project, it's no use of developing the project, it's no use of taking the project, right? It's like if we cannot, we don't know like what are the systems requirements are there. For example, if someone says that we want to develop a system to go to moon like via a software, that won't be possible for us because we need to think about the hardware and the software part. Okay, so also that technical feasibility will also include also the skills of the technical team, the people who will develop the product. Are they like well equipped with the system? if like some people, whatever the development platform is used, like, but in our organization we don't have such skilled person, then it's no use, it will be a failure, right? So this written are also the feasibility study. It will give a report whether there exist correct required resources and technology. So I told you, right, after the requirement gathering, we go for the software requirement specification. So this feasibility study will have the all the where all the resources, all the persons we have on, all the technology that is required for the project, or is like available to us or not. And obviously, we need to what technologies we need to upgrade it. So about the maintenance, so everything is mentioned in the technical feasibility. So moving to the operational feasibility, we have like all the service requirements. How easy will the software be to the so how easy to use the software will be by the end users, will they like easily like operate it, or after like if they it's possible to add like after the project is created, will there be any scope for adding new modules? Like I gave an example of the WhatsApp, right? In the WhatsApp before, it was used only for like texting messages and everything, chatting only, but later like in that same WhatsApp, what upgradation, new modules were added, like whether you say of the normal voice call or like video chat and new emoticons, like you can attach file also. I think for now it's only 18 MB or limited to some file is there, I think 25 MB, 18 MB is there, but later I think later we can increase the capacity of that one also. This kind of feasibility, like operational feasibility, like once you make a project, so upgradation like it should be allowed, whether it should be allowed to add more modules to it. Otherwise what happens is you need to create another project from scratch, so which is not always feasible. So that is why we go for operational feasibility, to check that whether we can go for the new addition of new modules or not. So all these things falls under this operational feasibility. Next is the economic feasibility. So economic feasibility, as the name suggests, it finds out, it works with the cost and benefit. So it will analyze the cost of the project, whether the like project amount required to create the project and like develop the project and the amount given by the client is like feasible, will be okay or not for carry on, if we go on for the development. So all these things are analyzed, because the sometimes the cost of the project like what is analyzed, like they, because I told you, right, the clients, they have lots of requirements that they, but they are not required to pay huge money for that one. So in that case it won't be feasible in that case, right? So it's make sure that, because all the hardware technical things, they cost us some money, not actually huge amount of money. So we should make it like economical. All the devices are available, whatever software is required, it's made available. So all these things comes under the, where we think about the cost, or this thing comes under the economic feasibility. Okay. Next is the legal feasibility. So legal feasibility, as the word suggests, legal means it means some kinds of all the guidelines, and from the legal point of view, whether like the government agencies, your project you are developing is mentioned, like it's developed according to some standards or not. So IT also have some standards, okay? So we go for all the like IT governance standards. You'll be studying about this when you, I think, in your fourth sem. Yeah, fifth sem, IT governance, a subject is there. Well, you will be studying like all the legal point of view, various standards where they're like legal implementation of project. Like when you develop a project, it needs to pass through several standards. Legal standards are there, like ISO is there, ITIL is there. So all these things, it may satisfy with other, because any organization which does not follow all the standards, then we don't trust that, right? Proper licensing is required. So everything is, should be found out in the legal feasibility, okay? So legal feasibility will basically mean it, the project will conform to the ethical requirements, all the legal and ethical requirements, a valid one, right? We are following the government guidelines. And the last one is a schedule for feasibility. So schedule, as the name suggests, schedule means time. Right. So you are like whether the project can be developed within a like time frame or not, like within a given timeline or not. If not, suppose we if we the project takes much longer than like no, because the what kind of technologies we want right now, it's not available to us. Then in that case, we cannot develop it, and that the deadline will cross, right? So that case, like it won't be scheduled feasibility, because suppose you develop your project, your major project in 6 months of time, but you take a project that may not be like completed in 6 months. That needs like more than, because you have taken a complex project which may at least require 2 years for completion, but you have only 6 months in hand. In that case, that is not scheduled feasibility feasible. Okay, but if you have a small project, obviously we know that it can be completed within like 6 months, and that is why we say it's scheduled feasible. Okay, so this was all about the feasibility study. Any confusion? So this is a scheduled feasibility. The feasibility study, these things actually comes under the FDLC model only, but I think I was left with this topic, so I discussed it today. Okay, and that also we have discussed the types of feasibility also. So let me move to the next topic of today then. Just wait for some time. So coming to the last topic for like module 2 is the behavioral modeling. Till now we have seen all the functional modeling, then we have seen the data modeling, and the last topic we remained is the behavioral modeling. Okay, so in the behavioral modeling, so here what happens is we show the dynamic nature, okay, dynamic sequence, okay, the dynamic nature of the system. So what happens, it shows basically the interaction, how the systems interact with each other. Okay, so here are a few diagrams are there. We have activity diagrams, interaction diagram, and use case diagram. But we'll not study about these diagrams. I'll just show you only one diagram here as for example, just to explain you what is this behavioral model and interaction, and because we'll not go for it, because UML part is not included in your syllabus, so I'm not going through it. Just it's written about the behavioral, but I just wanted to give you just depth knowledge about these diagrams. So activity diagrams, you can think of something like the flowchart. The flowchart and the activity looks all similar, the same thing, but in flowchart we don't describe everything, but in activity we give the description of the entire system, how the system works. Similarly, we have the use case interaction. Interaction will not discuss, so we'll go for today only the use case diagram. First, let us see how the use case looks like. So this is the use case diagram. Okay, so use case diagram for ATM, bank ATM. So here the symbols you are seeing, okay, I'll just explain you first the symbols. So these symbols you are seeing, so either you can these are known as actors, okay, ACTORS, actors. Here you can see actors means who will be the one, like who are the users of the system. Okay, so they are known, the users of the system are known as the actors. Okay, here it's like represented as bank, as a, they have shown as a diagram, but you can represent this bank also like this only, the actor only, because it is also an actor. Now, all these oval shapes you are seeing is known as the functionalities, okay, also known as the use cases. Okay, these are the functionalities known as the use cases. Okay, that means what are the functionalities that will be like inside the, that will be in the present in the system. The rectangle you are seeing is your entire system. The rectangle you are seeing is the entire system, and the marks you are seeing, that is the lines you are seeing, are the interaction between the actor and the functionality, how the user interacts with the system. So let me explain you. Like in an ATM, you first think of who are the ones who will be the who will be using the system. ATM system will be used by obviously customer, bank, and the ATM technician. Okay, what will the ATM technicians do? You people are clear, like, why customer and bank will be involved, but because customer, you know, they need to perform some kind of functionality. They need to insert the, because they need to like withdraw the money, check their balance. So these people need to use this such kind of functionalities. And also bank, because it's the bank who is providing the money, right? So because it's directly linked to the bank, so that is why bank. But why is this ATM technician involved? Because who will like go for the, like, if something, there is a fault in the machine, who will go for the regular checkup, right? Whether the like money is there or not in the machine, whether it's working properly or not. So it's, that is why we have another actor, that is the technician. Now these are the actors we have. Now we have to find out what are the functionalities of the system. What are the functionality of an ATM machine? So this kind of use case was developed when the ATM did not came into picture. So for any system, like from any, going through any case study also, you can develop your own project. Suppose you want to automate something. So why was this ATM developed? The ATM was developed just because people wanted to avoid the queues in the bank, standing in queues for long hours just to withdraw money or to just to check their balance. It's useless. It creates a lot of headache for the customer also and for the people working in the bank too, right? So to avoid that, like, people came up with the system known as the ATM machine. Okay, so in ATM machine, what the customers can do, they can check the balances. This deposit funds, I'm not sure about, they can deposit the funds. It's not deposit funds, right? Withdraw cash, obviously. Transfer funds. Also, lab technician maintenance and repair. And bank has the authority to do everything. This is just a simple example. So different functionalities may be there. So transfer funds, like from ATM, is not possible. I don't think so. It's ATM for transfer funds and deposit funds is there. But obviously, you can check balances and you can withdraw cash, right? Similarly, this lab technician can go for maintenance and they can go for repair. Okay. Suppose if maintenance is like, they need to check whether there is like money available on the system. So this customer have the permission to check this four functionalities, four use cases. Okay, check balance, deposit funds, withdraw cash, transfer funds. And this technician has the facility for maintenance and has a permission for maintenance and repair. But bank has the authority for all. So this is your, how the system will work. Okay, you can consider the bank is the admin who has the permission for everything. He can check what the customers are there, how much balance is present in the customer, how much money the customer has deposited in his account, then obviously how much money has withdrawn, then how much money has transferred, like if there is problem in the, because a single bank have like different ATM sources, right? Suppose we have Axis Bank. So Axis Bank ATM is present everywhere. Go for SBI. So SBI ATMs are present in every nooks and corners. So all these things, all the bank has the permission for everything. Okay. So this is what is known as the use case diagram. Okay. And this is your entire system. This is the ATM. You can think of the ATM machine. Who can operate it and this thing, the entire system. Let's go for, like, why do we go for the use case diagram? Basically, it is used to gather information of a system. So yeah, we get a brief idea, like who will be the customer of the system, then what will be the functionalities. So we just gather requirements, right? What are the functionalities will be, and obviously an outside view. We are not like how it will work, we are not concerned about it, but we get a clear idea about the functionalities, right? External and internal factors influencing the system. So looking by the diagram, we can find out what are the things that are influencing the system, right? Who are the like external and internal? So what are the external and internal? Is the internal is the bank and external is the customer and the technicians. And also show the interaction among the required among the requirements and the actors. So you can just see here the customer, like they have the authority for checking the balances, deposits, withdraw cash and transfer plot. Similarly, ATM has like maintenance and these are nothing but the interaction only, but bank has the authority for doing everything, right? So when drawing such kind of diagram, we should first, like there is a tip is there, we need to function, like whenever given us like case study, we need to find out what will be the functionalities, we need to what the system can do. We need to identify the system, what the system can do, right? Then we need to find out who are the actors, right? Who will be the, who are the actors of the system, whether it will be human user or some internal application. Then obviously the relationship between the actor and the use case. So these are the like guidelines for the use case diagram. So here is written the name of the use case is very important. So it's the like we know that we represent the use case using an oval shape, okay? And always remember that oval shape cannot be left empty. You need to name it. Like this, the this name is the check balances or the deposit funds. You cannot just leave it empty. So it's very important to have a name for it. Then give a suitable name for the actor. Similarly for the actors also. And also next one is show relationship and dependencies clearly in the diagram. Now dependencies we have not included here. I'll show you next diagram where we'll have some dependencies. So we need to mention clearly in the diagram all the relationships and diagrams. So do not try to include all types of relationships. So various types of relationships are there. We'll just not I'll not go into the depth of it. And also we'll use note when required to clarify some points. So we can use like in PPT also, we can go for some note here also, we can go through it. So here is example of an airport check-in and security screening. So here you can see various relationship is there. Okay, there. I think you people haven't studied that one. I'm not going through it. Like in RDBMS, aggregation is there. Okay, that kinds of. So for now, just leave it. We have a simple description. So this passenger, you can see these are the actors. Okay, these are the actors. We have, this is known as generalization. Okay, these are the what I was talking about, like aggregation, generalization. So this is the passenger. Now you see you have different actors, passengers can, different actors like tour guide, minor passenger, passenger with special needs. Tour guide, minor passenger, passenger with special needs, all can be generalized into one person or like one common name, that is the passenger. That is why we give the symbol this one. This is known as generalization. We are generalizing all types of actors as a single actor. Okay, this is a passenger. Tour guide, minor passenger, passenger with special needs. We are representing as one. It's known as a passenger. Then we have various use cases. Okay, what are the use cases we have? Individual checking, security checking, baggage checking, counter checking, kiosk checking and baggage handling. Now group checking will also include individual checking, right? And bagging checking, it extends. This is also one kind of relationships, like include and extend. So if you want to make, like if your system is really complicated, then you can use such kinds of like include and extend. So obviously we have this group checking, something we have for the airport, we have group checking. So group checking, if there is something group checking and individual checking, so it will also include, this group checking will include like individual checking. Similarly, the baggage checking that is done in the airport will extend to the individual checking. Then next we have this, again, generalization is known as individual checking consists of this. Like we can also say that counter checking and kiosk checking is called to individual checking. And then we have baggage handling. So it will extend to this one. And extend is represented, extend and include are represented by dotted arrows, dotted lines. Okay. So See, just to explain you what is about the use case diagram, so that is why I'm just showing you, like, it's not so much important for your examination point of view because the UML modeling is not there, but just to tell you the dynamic behavior of the like interaction of the behavioral diagram, I'm showing you this thing. Okay, so we know this oval shape means the use cases, right? And this is the generalization we have used. This counter checking and kiss comes as the generalization for individual one. Okay, and the dispersal for the airport obscurity, airport checking and security screening. Next one is for restaurant system. So for restaurant system, who are the actors? Customer, advertiser, supplier, candidate, contractor. So it may vary according to you based on your thinking. This diagram may vary. Okay, so we can't say if you include all the points, then these functionalities may have different names for you people. So everything can be connected because this is the dynamic nature. Based on our thought process, based upon your idea, the project needs to be developed. So that is why it is known as the dynamic nature. So you have, what does the customer do in the business restaurant? So it has meal. Have meal, have two generalization, okay? They can have lunch, they can have dinner. So we have generalized at have meal. Then advertiser, what did he do? So only advertise. Then supplier, like provide the supplies to the restaurant. And then candidate, they can, like candidates, like many people work in a restaurant also, right? So they apply for job. And contractor, they if they have any problem, repair, like if their light is not working, their table is, I think, broken or something, they need to repair it. So based on your perspective, you need to draw such kind of system. So this was all about the behavioral model use case diagram. So I hope this like is clear, right? It's behavioral modeling shows the dynamic nature. So that is why it's a dynamic sequence. It may vary according to the perspective. Like now, anyone not clear about this two topic, behavioral model and like what feasibility study we study today? Yes. Okay, I'll share you the slides. Okay. I got one reply. Okay, I'll share with you the slides. Please go through it. Understand, I just to explain you the behavioral modeling, I showed you this diagram. This diagram is not so much important. Like, I won't, like, probably give you to draw the diagram. Probably in the physical class, I have asked you to draw the diagram. But I request everyone, like, to, like, go through the slides. I'll be sharing with you. From tomorrow, we'll be studying Module 3. So, we are end with module 1 and module 2. So since I'm repeating once more, I think probably on next Monday, we'll be having your quiz in the cracking platform, okay, for module 1. So please go through it, like module 1 slides, please go through it, everyone, everything is important. So I have not prepared the question paper yet, so I can't tell you, but please prepare well. We'll have a quiz, just a revision type of thing. So that you open the slides. Just wait for some time. Let me take the attendance and then. Okay. Thank you, everyone. You all can leave now. We'll have class tomorrow.